this tall. We may have run across one another, but I can't tell. What I wanted to do today is talk a little bit about what Armenia is going through, expand on the reasons that it may be going through, and suggest some thoughts on what the next steps are. But before I do that, perhaps I want to start from the end. For years, like many of you, I followed the works of Professor Lavanisian and others, when they take bits of data from our past, 100 years ago, thousands of years ago, build articles, books around them, and educate us and inform us. It's hard work, because often we have to dig up this information to be able to do a story about it. So when we look at Armenia today, the country is awash with data. You can get data on just about anything you want. What people typically eat, you know, how many abortions they have, how many computers they have access to, what their education is, how many children they have, how many of them are sick, how many of them are working in Russia. I can go on and on. Census data, household survey data. How much research we see on Armenia, how many publications, with the exception of one or two perhaps associated with international organizations, one or two perhaps at the American University, zero. We don't have research done that appears in any of the top publications. Tier 1 publications, Tier 2, Tier 3, I can go down the list. But Dr. Professor Manusia is hard work. Doing research in Armenia should not. Now, all of us have these great ideas of what we want to do with this country, but what do we base our thoughts on? I see all these great ideas coming from Europe. Let's complain about this, let's complain about that. I'm sure that the Diaspora has a lot of wonderful ideas. But what is research back? What do we base our information on? What motivates us to take on the next step? Anyway, that's the lecture part. Let's move on to the substance. So when we look at Armenia, again, working backwards is a bit difficult, but one reason it's difficult is that I got here at 1 o'clock in the morning, realized I didn't have my USB drive for the PowerPoint presentation. Spent a few hours going over the paper I'd emailed Pago, and tried to recreate the PowerPoint, and then went to Target, buy USB drive, and create all this. But anyway, hopefully I'm all together. So what you have in 91 is a major chart. Armenia transition to a modern economy, a new economy. And he had shocks after shocks. The bigger shocks are the blockades, the war. One thing we don't pay attention to is that one of the key difficulties Armenia faced is that because it's after the dissolution of the Soviet Union, Armenia soon lost its jet markets and all that. But the border next door, Turkey, could have given it access to all the Western amenities, all the Western technologies. For those of you who flown to Yerevan in the early 90s, as I have, jet fuel was a big issue. Big deers, 30 miles away from Zvartovets, and the border was closed. Now, politically, we say the border with Turkey was closed in 93. In economic terms, the border was never open. You find very little statistics, and the Turkish statistics agency, Turkstat, has exceptional data, zero exports for you. So essentially, Armenia was blockaded both in terms of the economics vis-a-vis its traditional partners, but also was blockaded from the east by Turkey, by the east by Azerbaijan, from the west by Turkey, from the south by Iran because of the terrain, because there was no infrastructure, so you couldn't trade much. And then Georgia has its own civil war, so you had to blockade with Georgia. And these blockades continue. Georgia had a war with Russia. Russia closed the border with Georgia, and by doing so, it ended up blockading Armenia. So nothing could be shipped from Armenia to Russia, except that you ship it to Georgia, then it gets transferred by train to the Black Sea, then puts on barges, and shipped out to Russia, and then shipped back by trains. So you can see the transportation costs and all that. So the difficulties are horrendous. You have the global crisis, you have regional crises, geopolitical, where the US levies sanctions on Russia, the Russian economy suffers, the Armenian migrant workers suffer. But none of these shocks are external. Some of them are self-imposed. If you go back to the 90s, Armenia, the government did its best to preempt privatization, so no foreign investment. And the data we verified. The second thing that the government did, it preempted the integration.
integration, the economic integration of the diaspora. We're not talking about a few millionaires or billionaires providing aid to Armenia or working with them, but also there's this issue of what do you do with the hundreds of thousands of Armenians who could potentially move to Armenia? Well, at least they do visit, right? So some of them may end up staying. Essentially, the property rights did not exist, economic rights didn't exist. You can buy a house, you can start a business. No, you could, and the way you would do it is you get somebody local, you give them some money, they buy the house in their house, in their name, and guess what, 2 years later, you couldn't claim the property back because it was registered in somebody else's name. So you can go on and on. So the government essentially kept the private foreign investors out in the 90s, but also kept the diaspora out. Now, this isolation didn't just end in the 1990s. You still have current isolation today. A good chunk of the population that works in Russia. And as I will show you later, they essentially are not going to places where the technical skills are cherished or where you know it's not usable. They go and do manual labor. They do not really, they have no exposure to any thoughts, Western or otherwise. And also, you look at some universities, the students, of course, with the exception of the American university, have little exposure to outside, they have little government interaction with foreigners, I would say. And the biggest issue, and I think some people have remarked, have addressed this before, is very lack of investment in education. Not only by the government, I mean, the government has limited resources. I think they spend about $600 million today, and that comes everything from elementary to secondary to universities and all that. But even the international organization, it's not part of their objective, goal, essentially, to fund education. They do, but it's not. It's not their primary goal So today I'll just briefly review the economic performance of the economy, how it developed, the migration patterns, look at the demographic imbalance. Why do I say the demographic imbalance? We're talking about emotions, more boys than girls. As I'll show you later, it's the other way around. We have an existing imbalance that far, far more women than men, and that could be creating a lot of issues. And talk a little bit about state of foreign investment and remittances and so forth, in which give Russia a very prominent role in the development economy. And then follow up with some of the comments. Now, once you have seen this picture, not a pretty picture, GDP growth in Armenia. If you look at the early years, you have total collapse of the economy. So, you can attribute this to the fact that Armenia lost its traditional trading partners, but also, for those of you living here in the early 90s, at some point you had all inclusive. So, it wasn't just that your trading partners were gone, but it's the infrastructure is no longer able to support a reasonable lifestyle. You have electricity, no running water, you go on and on and on. And you have the blockade, so you couldn't trade up north with your traditional partners, but you couldn't go west because Turkey was blocking your way. You couldn't go south again because of terrain and the situation in your mind. Then it's a little bit better, and then you end up with the Asian crisis, financial crisis. Then in the late 1998, you had the Russian crisis, where the oil prices collapsed and the Russian economy collapsed. Things got better until we ended up with the global financial crisis, and then the economy tanked. Things get a little bit better, then the Russian economy suffers, then we have sanctions on Russia, and you can see how external factors could really be impacting what's going on in Armenia. So a lot of things happen in Armenia that are beyond control of the government. The biggest issue, the biggest concern that anyone was worried is this reversal, where Armenia was known to be a highly industrial economy, turning into a highly agrarian economy. So essentially, we turned into a nation of farmers. So about 35% of the labor force is in agriculture. This is 2015. It was a little bit higher, but I assume it's the migration. It's the migrant workers, or these farmers even, and moving to Russia for the summer, in fact, might be making the summer higher. But again, this is sizable. So you have 379,000 people engaged in agriculture. Now, these aren't big farmers. Often these people have small houses with small plot land, and essentially it's more or less subsistence. If you think that 370,000 workers, that's two kids and a wife and so forth, you can end up with a sizable number of the population that is living on subsistence. These are the people who, because of their needs and so forth, these aren't at the forefront of what some people would want to talk about freedom and liberty and all that. These people are really struggling to put food on the table for their family. this always comes up. Things get tough, what do you do? Well, we know we have about 20 million people every year slushing around the world. These are immigrants, refugees, whatever you want to call them, moving east, west, anyway to get a better life for their kids. And Armenia is not an exception. If you look at the early 90s, you have, these are figures look at the net departures from the country that have arrived. And you can see this massive collapse of 250,000 in 92. More people leaving the country than coming back. This is the only data that is only for air transport. The red one that I have here is for total, includes land and air, of course, it's land and air. And you can see that things got better by the 2000s. And then with the financial crisis, things got worse. So we have about 40,000 or so net people leaving. The interesting about these numbers, and I think maybe some more work needs to be done, not people leaving the country has declined when you look at air only. So fewer people leave than arrive by air, which tells us that they're leaving by land. And that's a bit complicated. So one thought would be perhaps it's cheaper to go to DC, Georgia, and fly from there. But again, I think this is definitely requires more work. Another aspect of this that should be of interest. Remember I said earlier we preempted the end of the diaspora? So much of the economy is destroyed in 1940. The industries are gone, the educational system is actually something considerably overrated. So if you should be in the diaspora, why would you go live there, right? You have no job, no education, and so forth. Now, you can move forward and you can say, well, things got better, why not move now? Well, things didn't get better because you're still part of the rebuilding mode. And if you look at the net people, let's say 2015, how many people left Armenia? And what is the net number? Leaving, coming back. The countries that come to mind in terms of the diaspora, say, okay, how many Russians or Armenians from Russia? I don't know really the ethnicity of these individuals, we only know citizenship, the passport, but we can guess more or less what the greater diaspora would be. So if we look from Georgia, it's consistently more people are coming from Georgia than leaving. But again, the number is small, and that's fluid, it's just next door. If we look at Iran, we have about 700 people on average, more people coming to Armenia leaving. But these may not be Armenians, they could be just Iranians. If you walk down the street of Yerevan, you would see all the signs of Parsi. We look at Iraq. Yeah, I mean, the numbers vary all over the place, but they can start people who come and stay, more people who come and stay. It's consistently positive, but it's again, less than about 300 more Lebanese come and stay than leave. Syria, a big number, and again, it's not. They add up over time, but we're looking at 1 or 2,000 Syrians staying in Libya. So clearly, I should say clearly, one would guess that things would have been different in 91 had the economic integration of the diaspora been made possible. Very simple. You had factories that weren't, you had an outstanding educational system. Those are gone. And they're not an exception, they're not enough, but they're much, much weaker. And so essentially, you don't have this replenishment that one would hope for. I'll give you an example. Israel is a good example. Because, I'll give you one number. In the 1948 or so, this year, 1948 to 1960, I had to download this from a old blog I printed in that. You had about 800,000 people living in Israel. You have the problems in Egypt in 56, right? The naturalization, all that, a lot of Jews left. You have problems in Hungary and the Czech Republic in 56. About 870,000 Jews migrated to Israel in this period. And in 1956, or in this period, Israel was not a panacea. It was not really, you know, as well off today. You know, it was a rough place. But people went. And one reason they went, because they were allowed to. They had the opportunity to go. It didn't matter what their social status was, their nationality, their citizenship, they would let in. We're in a different place. I mean, I can go on with this, but eventually this paper will be made available. Often, when we talk about migration and all that, we don't really pay attention to what else is going on. And one of the things that often distracts us is the demographics. We don't really know who's leaving generally. We can guess. And more recent data tells us. So we don't really know much about who left earlier. Well, one figure that has become a hot button issue is the demographic imbalance. And it's true, aside from the ethical moral issues, often having more abortions, we have fewer girls than boys, every year we're losing about 1,300 girls. By 2016, there'll be fewer 67,000 boys, and that's a big catastrophe for Armenia.
Well, there are far more boys for women now than there are girls.
I mean, boys also.
If you look at the numbers,
if you look at the country as a whole,
for every 100 women, there are 85 men.
I would say 85 men. And the numbers get worse as you get older.
So I'm not saying the country is awash with women, but I don't know if there are any sociologists here, but it doesn't take much to guess what would happen when you have a few Armenian men focusing on not just you, but all Armenian chasing too many women. I can imagine, but two also given the economic deprivation of the boys. I can expand on that, and you can tell a lot of stories. Again, I'm not a sociologist, but it's not my place to tell them. And that can't be healthy for an economy. And when you have too many, you have too much of a good thing, what happens? You get nameless. Again, I'm guessing this. It's not my nature as an economist to guess. We're supposed to be data-driven and analytical and all that. There's a paper behind this that will come up in Armenian rural economics. It's an old data, but women get paid less than men. Now, you can say that's universal, but a scientist Armenian shouldn't be getting paid less than a scientist Armenian man, outside women. But it does happen, and it does happen at every education level. From those who have least education to the less high education, you can see over and over and over women get paid less and less and less and less. Question is this because we're men and we're Armenian, that could be it, or is it just things have changed? This is beyond my expertise, but these are some of the symptoms we see. So we've done a lot to keep the men out, I mean, the diaspora out. We have the out-migration that's not being replenished, but we're also keeping the foreign investors out. If you look at the early 90s, nothing's happening. No foreign investors. So the one meetings, one of the meetings, and people, we should attribute that analysis. Often if you're a government official, you would say, these are hard times. If I were to sell these businesses and privatize them, I will sell them very cheap. Why not wait for a better time? And the question is, well, the better times ever come back? And if they don't, what happens? Your industry turns into this. Your factories close down, your supply chains disappear, your customers disappear, your workers leave. And essentially, you end up with a situation where the lack of conversation, lack of foreign investment is self-imposed. The spike you see here is primarily because Armatel, a big company, buying the Armenian. So in the 90s and the early 20s, the 2000s, the Greeks were the people often accused of destroying the Armenian economy and monopolizing it because they monopolized the tunnel. Now, complain is what the Russians do, and on and on and on. Anyway, so the point is that we had very little investment. So the question is, if you want transition, and if you don't let people in to be the catalyst, how do you end up with a transition? You don't let the diaspora in, you don't let foreign investors in, you isolate yourself. And I know this probably is different from the story that they wanted to tell, but that's a topic for a different discussion. But essentially, a policy essentially that kept all these potential capitalist nuts. So investment did go up, as the previous chart shows, but it did very little. If you look today at the stock of foreign investment in the country, it's about $3.8 billion. That's what total investment is. So it's not the total cumulative investment, it's cumulative investment less than depreciation, wear and tear, and so forth. So, I mean, for a country of 2 million, this is very tiny. If we look at much of the investment in the early 90s, Greece was the top. They were the first, they came in to buy the telephone company, they were the first to invest in the banking sector, and so forth. Russia didn't come in until later on. And mostly Russia came in the 2000, 2005, 2006, as they started acquiring some of the telephone companies. But overall, they account for less than half of the capital stock, but again, it's very tiny. So essentially, if I were to look at it in terms of foreign investment, it's small and not adequate. So
So we have a team earlier in terms of the transition and the catalyst. Well, one key question is that, one way you can get into action is by working overseas. Working overseas in Armenia means you're in a country, you hop on a plane, and you fly in a charter to places in Russia, you work for 4 or 5 months, you can make about $10,000, you come back home. The question is, what are you doing and where do you go? So this is a chart prepared about 10 years ago. For those of you who work in aerospace and get better data, so one thing I would do in the past, I would go to Zonda's website, which is the main data that changed, and you can actually get the schedule of flights to these areas. So I would go every year and I would grab these and figure out where people fly. And the advantage of this is that you don't just see people go to Moscow, because essentially a lot of flights that go through all these areas go to Moscow and so unfortunately, Zonda's doesn't have this anymore. And so any thoughts on this, I would be grateful. If you can see from this map, I don't know how many of you are from this part of the world. Once you move from the east, right, you're in central Russia. This is pure manual work. So people go, work their tail off, make their $10,000, come back home, and feed their family, and then a few months later, they stop. They leave on to this over and over. Most of the villages are empty because the men are typically working in these areas. And these people are going to come back. And essentially, they're going to really promote democracy and freedom and so forth. So it's a tough call. Okay, so what do they do? They send money back home. So the red line is when money gets transferred from Russia. This is one thing. Monthly by itself isn't very useful. The only reason I share monthly information with you is you can see the spikes. You see when people are working and when the money goes out. And it's mostly the summer times, as you can see. And it's consistent. It's also consistent with geopolitical concerns and global crises, right? The 2009 crisis, the sanctions on Russia, and so forth. Another picture which could tell us a little bit more, I brought this to an angle here. And one thing you would see at times, and you can scratch your head, why would this be true? That these are net businesses, essentially looking at money that comes into Armenia, less money that goes out of Armenia. And at times you can see what comes from Russia on a net basis exceeds the total. So Armenia gets close to, let's say 2016, that about $600 billion in net remittances, about $700 million left in the country. So gross remittances are about 1.3, 1.4. Okay, I'm not listening to this discussion. Money is coming in, but a lot of money is going out. It's not going out to Russia. Armenia gets a little money from the US, and often that whatever money gets from the US is a negative. Essentially, more money comes to the US than it goes. So, I mean, it's interesting, but it's interesting. It's a useful source of funds, obviously, if you're poor, but again, it tells you something about the political crises. And external shocks, as well as the growing need for remittances as more Armenians travel. I don't know how much time I have here. The question is where do we go from here? I mentioned earlier about the works of Professor Williams and others, research and all that. One key area it stands is investment education. With the exception of the American University, there's very little potential in the area of economics. No research has been done, nothing's been published. Again, there are a lot of publications, but essentially we're talking about academics, publications that stand up to scrutiny and peer review and so forth. They only exist. So one area is to increase spending on education. This need not come from the government. But the government, I'm sure, probably cannot spend more. But again, the idea is that this needs to be done. Other areas don't require any spending. So essentially, the large internationalization has self-funded on economic development and all that, and moved all the way to spend money on civil society and democracy and all that. And they've been doing this for a long time. I think if they had a better way of doing it, I think they would certainly by now. And my thing is that why not spend this on the universities? Why not have universities as incubators of democracy and civil society and so forth? You have 10,000 students graduated every year. That's 250,000 students that have graduated since independence. What are they doing? are not employed, what are they contributing to society? Could they, with the exception of those who've done some technical work and all that in terms of sciences and all that, I have no idea. The other area is that often government, international organizations spend a lot of money on reforms. Tax reform, investment reform, they spend tens of millions, 20 million, 50 million. And they set aside a portion of these funds for education. You know what that means? That means the private entity that's doing the consulting work will set up some conferences at a hotel where they present their work or produce some benefits. And I'm thinking, I don't know, this would be hundreds of thousands of millions. Why not spend these in the universities? So we look at Armenia, there's not a single professor here currently. We do not have a single professor who has a PhD in finance working full time in the country. I could be wrong. We do not have a person, I know this for a fact. We talk about government administration, public administration. There's not a single person at the public administration academy that a single professor who is trained in public administration. No. We do not have a single economist in Armenia who is an expert on transportation economics. I can go on and on and on. And the question is, you know, the funds are there. Why are they really being directed into this area? The last area I want to add, this could include the diaspora, not just, you have to do more research. You can't really simply have policies that are not driven by data. You can't go on and say, I know what you're kidding. We've said this many times. The research does not exist. Many of you are scientists, you can go to your journals, you can find all the work you've done. Whether you're in civil engineering or electrical and so forth, you have your journals, your publications. Don't you have any CRM? They don't exist. That'd be so. Thank you.
He's a professor, doctor of economics, and author of 10 monographs and more than 500 scientific